Thanks very much. To start with the obvious, it is always a pleasure to come to Warsaw, and it's an honor to deliver a lecture in the name of Kapuscinski. I will not go into the details of the Swedish-Polish relationship during history. My former Polish colleague, Radek Sikorski, used to lecture me on all of the cities that had been burned down by the different Swedish armies during a couple of hundred years, and somewhat reluctantly towards the end of those lectures said that it was nearly forgotten and nearly forgiven. But we take some pride in saying that I think it was Sigismund who made Warsaw the capital of Poland. I'm not quite certain that is popular in every part of Poland, so delete that from the webcast, but in Warsaw I hope it is. But now some remarks on the subjects that we are supposed to address. We certainly live, that's fairly obvious, in turbulent times. It was a little more than a decade ago that the European Union, in its first European security strategy, loudly proclaimed that Europe has never been so free, so secure, nor so peaceful. The violence of the first part of the 20th century has given way to a period of peace unprecedented in European history, end of quote. But now, as the European Union is trying to put some strategic thoughts to paper, it has to say that, quote, the world has become more dangerous, divided, and disorienting, end of quote. And the perspective from other actors is certainly not dissimilar. Appearing before a Senate committee a couple of months ago, Henry Kissinger said that, and I quote again, as we look around the world, we encounter upheaval and conflict. The United States has not faced the more diverse and complex array of crises since the end of the Second World War, end of crisis. And, to quote another statesman or whatever, President Putin of Russia, in his Valdai speech of last year, he very bluntly said that, and I quote, changes of the world order and what we are seeing today are events on this scale have usually been accompanied by, if not global war and conflicts, then by chains of intense local level conflicts, end of quote. A decade ago, globalization was the decisive trend in global affairs. It had been given a boost by the opening up of China, by the demise of the entire Soviet Empire, and the ensuing widening of the European Union, by the profound reforms in India, and by the new technologies starting to reform our economies and societies. Davos, with its annual gathering of the great and the good of globalization, was a symbol of this emerging world of globalization. But today, it is undoubtedly very different. Not only is the performance of the global economy somewhat lackluster, but we've also seen geopolitical rivalry and tension make a fairly dramatic comeback. There's widespread debate about the long-term consequences of not only the economic, but also the political rise of China. And here in Europe, we have seen not only what is sometimes referred to as the hybrid warfare of the Russian smash and grab operation to take over Crimea, but also the conventional battles of the mechanized battalions of the Russian army in eastern Ukraine. Donetsk, the symbol of these battles, can be seen as the symbol of this comeback of geopolitics today. And for a while there was the belief, or perhaps rather hope, that the tide of terror had been turned back. The rise of Daesh or ISIS in Mesopotamia and the Levant, and its ability to strike out in Ankara, in Beirut, in Paris, has made us acutely aware of also this reality of our modern world. for me, the village of Dabiq, a bit outside of Aleppo in northern Syria, is the symbol of this tendency of our time. That is the place of the coming Armageddon of the jihadist fundamentalists. And it is accordingly also the title of the Daesh propaganda magazine. So there we have it, Davos and Donetsk and Dabiq. These are the forces dominating our times, battling for dominance, shaping the developments of regions and nations. And the task of policymakers in these times is far from an easy one. We face a series of complex challenges that severely strain the ability of the international community, be that the United Nations system in all its different incarnations, or be that the structures that we have built here in Europe to secure our peace and to promote our prosperity. We have to try to contain the forces of chaos and conflict, and we have to do our utmost to create the stability that is necessary for peace and prosperity. Time after time, we are likely to be called upon to intervene in the one way or the other to help with this. We have learned that instability also in faraway places do impact also upon our own societies in different ways. Refugees arrive, terror thrives, organized criminality gains ground, and conflicts can easily escalate horizontally as well as escalate vertically. The price of indifference risks being very high indeed. Interventions can take very many different forms, from just statements of policy over more ambitious diplomatic efforts to full-scale both military and political interventions in the different conflict-ridden countries or areas of the world. And as we discuss the different options that are there, we must do so based on the sometimes rather bitter experiences we have made during the last few decades in these respects. We have faced new conflicts in Europe itself. I'm now, as a matter of fact, on my fifth war in Europe. Bosnia until 1995, Kosovo in 1999, Macedonia in 2001, Georgia 2008, and Russia, Ukraine since 2014. But we have also answered the call for intervention in Afghanistan, and we are now more and more affected by the increasingly grave situations in the wider Middle East. My first war and my first peace was in Bosnia. And let me, to some extent, based upon what we learned during what was a decade of conflict in the Balkans, share with you some of the lessons that I believe are important also for the future. This autumn, as a matter of fact, it's two decades since international efforts finally managed to end the war in Bosnia, and it entered a period of peace and state and nation building that was to be far more complicated and far more demanding than most people had anticipated. The story of the international community and the decade of wars of dissolution in what was once Yugoslavia is, to be quite honest, not a particularly honorable one. We failed to see the war coming. And as we finally saw it coming, we failed to prevent it, and might even have contributed to initiating it. Then, as millions of people were forced to flee and tens of thousands lost their lives, we quarreled and thereby undermined the one peace effort after the other. It was only when the horrors defied belief, when those that were engaged on the ground threatened to get out, and those that hadn't risked being dragged in, that our minds were sufficiently focused to produce that international coherence around a realistic plan for peace, without which the conflict would have been dragged on for much longer. It is, as said, not a very heroic story. Then we failed again. Instead of using the momentum that was there and move forward on an obvious issue like Kosovo, we rested on the laurels that we had given ourselves and then became little more than witnesses to the slide of Kosovo into open conflict. Late in the day of that one, we tried to secure a peace agreement at a place called Rambouillet. But when we failed to secure that particular peace, we stumbled into war that ended without a peace. We had to hand over Kosovo to a decade in limbo under United Nations protectorate before some decided that independence was the least bad option and just moved ahead, leaving until this day key legal stability issues unresolved. But it has not only been the decade of wars of dissolution in former Yugoslavia that has tested the wisdom of the international community during these decades. Suddenly, it was necessary to crush a Taliban regime in Afghanistan that, by harboring terrorists, had turned itself into a threat against the international order and tried to set up a new legitimate state by the Hindu Kush. And then some found it necessary to depose the regime in Baghdad, destroy the state that had been there, and try to build a decent democracy in the ancient land of Tigris and the Euphrates. And continuing in the same spirit, international forces rushed to give air support to rebellion along the shores of Libya, eventually bringing down what little there was of a functioning state in the old lands of Cyrenaica, Tripolitania, and the Fezzan. And in parallel, of course, we've seen the return to conflict across the old post-Soviet space. The old issues, Nagorno-Karabakh, Transnistria, have not been sorted out. And disputes of Abkhazia and South Ossetia was used as a pretext for Russian move against Georgia. And recently, of course, we've seen Russian aggression against Ukraine in an attempt to stop that country's wish to be part of European integration. As a result, we now have no less than 6 more or less open or more or less frozen conflicts in this wider region, with all the dangers for the future that this obviously represents. But for today, I will leave those particular issues aside. Looking at the other challenges, and after the rather bitter experience of these decades, one would hope that there is a general recognition that it is not only winning or ending a war that is the important thing, that it is the transition to winning a peace, and the face of winning and ending the war must be seen as just the initial part of the far more complex and much more demanding task of winning a peace and paving the way for true development. To separate, like in the Balkan conflicts, war-weary armies is, after all, a somewhat less complex task than to bring together bitterly divided peoples that have been bitterly divided by the brutality of war, to bring them together again in a common effort to build a better future. As we tried 20 years ago to secure the peace in Bosnia, it took hard discussions until there was the readiness to accept even a rudimentary structure for political and civilian implementation. And as history moved on, there was an effort to include the lessons that we've learned in the Balkans in the different efforts that were to follow. But even the most positive observer must conclude that success, even then, has been somewhat elusive. And the tendency of the international community to walk away from the more demanding tasks of peace, state, and nation building, unfortunately, that tendency is still there. Looking back, over these often painful experiences, I believe there are seven lessons of nation building that I would like to share with you. I've talked about some of them before, but also updated them in light of developments over the years. Lesson one, after a conflict, it is imperative to establish a secure environment and to do it very fast. To establish a security environment is far more than separating armies or secure the withdrawal of an army or the demilitarization of armed groups, as in Kosovo, or the defeat of the armed formations of the old regimes, as in Afghanistan, in Iraq, or in Libya. The role of force in the post-conflict phase is to remove the military or violent options that are otherwise available to different actors, so that all of them are forced to explore political options, and so that all of them are truly free also to do so. As long as a gun is seen as the fastest way to either power or property, we can be certain that it will be used. And there simply will be no room for either a democratic dialogue to develop or for the entrepreneurship that is the basis for economic recovery to develop over the years ahead. The absence of a secure environment also impedes the different international efforts, not least in the humanitarian field, that are so absolutely essential in the immediate post-conflict phase. In the immediate post-conflict phase, there is often no alternative to the use of military force to establish this secure environment. It's an illusion to believe that there will ever be international police forces ready to deploy sufficiently fast in anything resembling the necessary numbers in such situations. Any serious security effort would also be able to have what we call an escalation dominance in any possible situation, and that effective means that military forces will have to be a critical part. We have faced the consequences of failure in these respects time after another. In Bosnia, we failed to secure a peaceful transfer of territories and populations in the critical 3 months period after the peace agreement came into force, thus suddenly getting up to 100,000 refugees from peace that were to vastly complicate the subsequent political process as well as the process of refugee return. In Kosovo, the mandate given to the NATO forces as they entered explicitly gave them overall security responsibility, but we still failed to give the remaining minority populations adequate protection. We could celebrate the speedy return of close to 1 million Kosovo Albanians, but we could not prevent that close to 250,000 Serbs and other minorities fled or were driven away, with all of the consequences this continues to have until this very day. In Afghanistan, after the fall of the Taliban regime, we deliberately limited the mandate for the International Security Assistance Force to Kabul, in spite of the requests, not least of the responsible UN officials. And from 2005 onwards, we accordingly saw the gradual comeback of the Taliban, forcing then a very substantial expansion of the international security efforts in order to protect the legitimate government of the country. And in Iraq after the 2003 invasion, it was obvious that planning for the post-conflict phase left much to be desired, and that there was a serious shortage of both quantity of soldiers and plans for how they should be used. The decision by the Bremer US administration in Iraq to disband virtually all of the structures of the previous regime, including the entire army, is probably one of the worst decisions in the history of efforts like these. It certainly contributed to the opening of the doors to instability that today haunts the entire region of the Levant and Mesopotamia. In Libya, after 2011, after the Gaddafi regime had been destroyed, naivety reached new heights, as virtually no effort was made to disarm different groups, some of which had been even armed by the international community, and some of which could just loot the massive arms stores of the previous regime. And here we saw the effects of instability also spread across the Sahara, making new interventions and international peace operations necessary. The Mali intervention, first by France, and now substantial UN forces, was only one of the consequences. Thus, the first lesson that we have to learn is that there should be no military planning for war operations that does not extend into equally serious planning for the post-war task of establishing a secure environment. If that fails, everything else will also fail. Lesson number two, the central challenge is not economic reconstruction, but state building. Too often it is said that the immediate task after conflict is reconstruction, pouring in money to rebuild houses, bridges, whatever else has been destroyed by the conflict. But I would argue that the key to success is to get the priorities right from the very beginning. The central challenge is nearly always state building. If that succeeds, other tasks will have the possibility of succeeding, while if it fails, we can be certain that everything else is bound to fail as well. Thus, right from the start, the focus of the international community effort have to be on the core task of building a political infrastructure that unites competing forces and ensures some sort of order and an infrastructure of economic governance that promotes jobs, trade, and growth. Somewhat under the influence of US terminology, there's talk of nation building, but the real task, I would argue, is state building. Because the essence of the situations that we are often confronted with is that there's too much nation and too little state. And the central task is therefore to build a state that has the legitimacy necessary to transcend the different national, ethnic, cultural, religious agendas that otherwise, of course, risk to tear everything apart. Lesson number three, to build a state, you need to know what state to build. Because states do come in different incarnations. And it is important to establish very early which type of state to build. The longer an uncertainty on this central issue lingers, the more difficult will it be to secure the agreement that is necessary for the process to succeed over time. Normally, this requires agreement on a constitution or a constitutional framework. In many cases, this means trying to resolve some of the very core issues that led to conflict from the beginning. In all of what I call the post-Ottoman area, from Bihać in Bosnia in the northwest to Basra by the Gulf in the southeast, we have been faced with essentially the same challenge of devising a constitutional framework that can be accepted by different national, cultural, religious, or ethnic groups. Yugoslavia, Iraq, and Syria was formed at the same time out of the same debris of empire, and the respective areas have many of the same problems in these particular respects. The Kosovo issue and the Kurdish issue is obvious similarities. But throughout the Muslim world, there's also the rising issues of identity between Sunnis and Shias. And in parts, there's also the continued and enduring importance of tribal structures. For all of the extensive efforts done since 2003, there's no denying the fact that the Iraqi state today faces a serious crisis of legitimacy from key groups, and that its dissolution, with vast implications for the entire region, is a real possibility. And as for Syria, of course, its future is highly uncertain. More than 4 years of war has brought not only vast physical destruction, but also torn apart much of the social fabric of the country. And much of the talent of the country has been forced to flee, many probably to make important contributions to the future development of Sweden or Germany or other European countries in the future to the detriment of the future of their own country. And between these different post-Ottoman areas, the Balkans and Mesopotamia, Levant, we have the efforts in the divided island of Cyprus, where the one peace effort of the other have failed over the years, and where it's only now that negotiations are perhaps bringing some hope of a resolution, but it's taken a long time. It was in 1963 that the United Nations first deployed troops on the island, and when its joint governance structures collapsed and has remained collapsed since then. In all of these cases, the task of state building is the task of preventing disintegration and getting different groups to accept that any lasting solution would have to be one that meets the minimum demands of everyone while not meeting the maximum demands of anyone. This must be facilitated by the international community very early and with a certain firmness, setting out the parameters of what can be accepted. The longer there is uncertainty over which state to build, the harder will be the positions that one day will have to be overcome. And until there is progress on which state to build, progress on setting up the different functioning state structures will be limited, with most other tasks accordingly held up as well. Lesson number 4. There must be an early focus on the preconditions for long-term economic growth. While, as I said, humanitarian issues are always in the focus in the initial phases after a conflict, it is dangerous to let them dominate over the longer-term issues. There must be an early focus on how to set up the economic frameworks and institutions most conducive to the creation of self-sustaining economic growth in the area. An early focus on issues like currencies and customs and taxation systems and commercial law and creation of a viable financing systems, debt restructuring, and clearing any legal obstacles to accessing international capital markets. In areas affected by economic sanctions, the problems are normally worse than in areas only affected by war. Since while war destroys physical infrastructure, sanctions also destroys the economic fabric of society by plunging the honest people into poverty and propelling the dishonest into sometimes truly immense richness. Sanctions destroy the hard-working and honest middle class that are the basis for any stable society. And while destruction can be fast, rebuilding is a very slow process. Indeed, Iraq again can be seen as a prime example of this development. We saw there how pre-war sanctions drove the middle class out of the country, while sanctions busting and smuggling created, as we saw in the Balkans, structures of richness and organized criminality that, when peace arrives, are still there and takes a long time indeed to get rid of. That lesson is an important one to learn. Lesson 5, there has to be a benevolent regional environment. In the Balkans, back to there, political change in Zagreb and Belgrade was key to improving prospects in Bosnia as well as in Kosovo. And subsequent steps towards regulating the position of Kosovo have been dependent on a common approach of the region to the question of integration with and within the European Union. In Afghanistan, which is bridging South and Central Asia, the open or tacit cooperation of all the neighboring states and regional actors is a precondition for long-term stability. And this has been somewhat belatedly recognized in the still much too tame so-called Istanbul process since 2011, meeting, by the way, on ministerial levels in Islamabad on Wednesday of next week. Iran was keyed to the bond process, setting up new Afghan state in 2002. But the role of Pakistan and its different instruments have been far more debatable and destabilizing. And it can certainly be argued that until Pakistan and India can overcome the bitter legacy of the partition of 1947, conditions for stability in Afghanistan will remain fairly precarious. In the case of Iraq, there is no question that the failure to establish a benevolent and coherent regional framework has contributed to the continuation of conflicts inside the country, with both Tehran and Riyadh seeing fundamental interests at stake. Long-term stability has been difficult to achieve. And the same, of course, applies to the failure to end the conflict in Syria, where we have seen divisions ranging from those in the UN Security Council to the different regional actors, making any peace effort up until this time very difficult indeed. Indeed, in the meantime, the conflict has become an amalgam of civil war, of sectarian strife, and of proxy war by regional and global actors. If there's any hope, it now rests with the process of dialogue now initiated in Vienna, although still in its very, very early stages. Any conflict, and equally any peace process, must be seen in the regional context. Sometimes we see borders from far, we are far away, and we see borders on the maps. But in the regions, these borders are sometimes arbitrary, sometimes not very important, and the conflict must also always be seen in the wider perspective. Lesson 6. The greater the international support, the easier the process. And this is, of course, fairly obvious. Peace efforts are demanding, they are long-term, they must be broadly based. Accordingly, one must seek for peace effort, preferably an even broader coalition than you have for either waging a war or closing down a conflict. I think that has been demonstrated time and again. And here, of course, some sort of framework by the United Nations or the legitimacy that can only be given by the resolution, by resolution of the UN Security Council is always extremely helpful, irrespectively of who and which actors are the operational ones on the ground. Lesson number 7, which follows fairly closely from what I've said. Nation building or state building or peace building takes a longer time and requires more resources than practically anyone initially believes in the middle of a conflict. I was the first high representative in Bosnia after the war, during the years 1995 to 1997, a long time ago by now. And I was told by the wisdom of the international community by the time that everything should be concluded within a year. Peace, go away, ready. When the folly of that was recognized, a new deadline of 2 years was given very generously. But it's now 20 years after the war, and there is still one of my successors as High Representative sitting in Sarajevo, with some international actors still considering this absolutely necessary in order to keep the country together. Peace building requires an abundance of patience as well as an abundance of resources. Today, there are around 110,000 persons deployed in United Nations peacekeeping operations across the world, to which should be added, of course, all those serving under the flags of the European Union, NATO, African Union, or other regional actors. But the demands of operations in primarily the Balkans and Afghanistan has led to the fact that the share supplied by our countries of Europe have diminished from 40% 2 decades ago to mere 7% today. And the United States today provides no more than 82 persons out of these 110,000 persons in UN peacekeeping operations. But for all of the deficiencies that are there in troop numbers, we face even larger deficiencies in other critical areas. Civilian administrators, judges, policemen, engineers, lawyers, the list is nearly endless. And this only underlines the wisdom of necessity of making a peace coalition as wide as possible in order to be able to draw on as large a pool of resources, talents, and experience and expertise as possible. It is a complex undertaking that requires all. But in spite of the fact that the experience of the last decades has led many to turn away from these tasks because they are seen as too difficult and too demanding, there is no doubt that we must prepare ourselves for more of these missions in the future. We know how failed or failing states also in distant areas can and do threaten our security. The jihadist terror structures establishing themselves in the contested and failed areas of the Middle East is clearly a threat to our societies. And there is no fail-safe protection until stability and order have been brought back to these areas. We also live in an era of migration. But the refugee challenge that the world faces today is of a dimension we have not seen since the years of and immediately after World War II. And there are no barriers high enough to shield us if the carnage of the Levant and other areas of the wider Middle East just continues. We have to engage, and we have to work together for solution. And at times, we also have to intervene to hold conflicts and try to build peace. As we sit here, efforts continue in Paris to reach an agreement to limit the effects of warming of our planet in the decades ahead. And there's also, of course, not only a development, but also a security perspective on this. If, in what was once referred to as the Fertile Crescent, where mankind first learned to farm, and where some of the first civilizations accordingly were set up, rising temperatures makes farming no longer possible. The implications of this, also for us, will of course be vast. And the same obviously applies when discussing the future of the soon 1 billion people to the south of the Sahara, a couple of decades ahead, going to be 2 billion people. Economic, social, and political development of these vast areas is a security issue also for Europe and for our societies. The countries of the Middle East and North Africa are approaching a population of 400 million people. But in a couple of decades, that figure will be 50% higher. This could, under the best of circumstances, be a demographic dividend for them and an economic opportunity for us. But with conflicts proliferating and economies stagnating, the risk at the present are rather, as they say, in the financial markets, distinctly on the downside. As we look around then, the turbulence is obvious, the tension seems to be rising, and it's imperative for us all, the so-called international community, to think hard on what we can and what we must do to prevent further conflicts, to meet the humanitarian needs that are out there, and to provide for a path to peace and prosperity to those regions that are now torn apart by chaos and conflict. And to do so, and that is my main point today, based also on what we have learned from our collective mistakes in the past. Thank you.
So, thank you very much for this thought-provoking lecture, and let us now turn to you, to the audience. So, if anyone feels like asking a question, please raise your hands. Okay, so we have first question over there. Where are the microphones? Just a moment. A microphone, Ania. Before you start, please wait until the microphone is in your hand, and please introduce yourself.
My name is Pavel Kuchma, doctorate candidate at the university. You didn't talk a lot about the education, the role of education in war preventing. How do you think this is important in the long run? Because it's obviously, in the first few years, it's very important to keep peace. And what then?
No, entirely correct. You said that I didn't talk much about it. As a matter of fact, I didn't talk anything about it. And the reason for that was that I was concentrating on a somewhat more immediate task. But when we then go on sort of with state building, I was concentrating more on the basic structures of state building. But then it comes to all of the normal issues of development. And accordingly, if you see the somewhat medium or long-term development of any society, it is dependent upon both the human resources, and those are very much facilitated by education, and by the institutional structures that makes it possible for individuals to develop according to their different abilities. Then there are conflict problems associated with education, but that's another issue. I've been, go back to the Balkans, but the same applies to the Middle East. And you will know this to some extent in your own country after the experience of the Second World War. When you start to teach history, for example, it gets very complicated indeed. So there are some sort of conflict resolution issues also when it comes to education, but preferably it should be isolated from those issues.
Okay, we have one more question over there.
Hello, I'm an international student here in Poland. I have a question regarding what you mentioned. Allow me first to begin by thanking everyone for organizing this event and for you, Prime Minister, for attending. But I will link my question to what you mentioned about the talent leaving Syria and contributing to Germany and Sweden in the future. So my question is, how is that possible? Because if we look at Sweden today, we find that there is a huge rise in some political parties who, like Swedish Democrats, back a couple of years ago, back in 1988, they had marginal support when they were formed. But today, we see them rising and 25% in the poll, and last year they passed this threshold. So my question is, how can we reconcile your view and the views of individuals which I might support, but with the other views of those who are there? So this is an issue about Sweden and its domestic politics. I believe this will create a lot of friction in the country. Maybe it's not good. It might not be good for the future of Europe and Sweden as well. So this is my question. Thank you very much.
No, and it's your question is about Sweden. I will answer it with Swedish examples, but I mean the same issue could apply to other countries. I mean, we have a vivid debate in Germany along the same lines at the moment, obviously. And you have the two things. I mean, first, when you have, as we're having at the moment, an influx of a fairly large numbers of refugees, then naturally that leads to some strain in society, because there's a financial burden, there's an organizational burden, because, I mean, now numbers are well beyond what our structures are designed to cope with. And people get worried. And there is a segment of society that feels left behind by developments anyhow. And we see a rise in this particular segment who's saying, stop this, I don't understand what's going on, this is too foreign to me, let's go back to the 1950s was better or whatever. Now I'm exaggerating slightly for the sake of the argument. And what will be the outcome of this is dependent upon to which extent we succeed with integration. And that you can only judge in a 10 or 20 year perspective. If I look at Sweden, and Sweden has, we have a history which was different from other countries, but might be of some importance. I mean, the by far biggest foreign community that we have is Finnish. And that's for all sorts of historical reasons. It also had to do with the fact that Finland after the Second World War was extremely poor. Sweden had an industry. It demanded or wanted to have sort of labor. But I mean, if you go to the Swedes today and say that we consider Finnish people to be immigrants, they would look at you. They're not. They're part of us. We took a fair number of refugees from the Baltic countries during the Second World War. We took some waves from the Iron Curtain countries. We took a fairly, in terms of numbers, I don't know how many there were that came out of Poland in the late 1960s when Gomułka was sweeping away a lot of people. They are extremely important in Swedish cultural life. Some of our leading media figures are Polish speaking and with Polish background. And you can see waves. We took more than 100,000 people from Iran after the revolution of 1979. They are more successful than most Swedes, I would say. It was, to a large extent, middle-class people from Tehran. We took 100,000 people from Bosnia. And that was very complicated indeed, because they came also in very large numbers very fast. And when we look at them today, there have been scientific studies, and you can do that because they've sort of 20 years have passed, and then you see things. They are, on their average, slightly better than the average Swedes. I mean, some have failed, haven't integrated. Some have been spectacularly successful. They've been in the European Parliament, in the Swedish government, and whatever. Most are fairly okay. Other groups, to be quite honest, Somalis, significant problems with integration because of enduring tribal structures. Iraqis, fairly okay so far. But it all comes down to which extent labor market and language and cultures that sort of they can accommodate and we can accommodate. If that succeeds, and that's a big if, then it's to the benefit of our society. There's no question about that. The fact that Sweden has had a fairly, we've had, for all sorts of reasons, a fairly good development of our economy during the last sort of 10 years. And this is one of the factors when we start to look at it, because we've got a demography that is better than countries that have a declining. If you've got a declining demography, you get a problem. It's very difficult to manage. If you've got a rising demography, it eases everything else. I'm saying this with a huge respect for the strains and the questions and the doubts and the problems that we're having when we have refugee flows of the magnitude that we're having at the moment. But then it is the task of political leadership to try to reconcile it. And I think it is possible, but it is very demanding. And why should not sort of deny the difficulties that are there in the immediate period, nor should one deny the rewards and the gains that could be there in the longer perspective. Somewhat long answer, but it's a rather critically important question these days, particularly.
Okay, there's a question here in the back.
Zbigniew Dąbrowski, Zofia Zamenhof Foundation. I would like to ask about your experience in Georgia. As I remember correctly, you were in Georgia in Tbilisi as a foreign minister of Sweden during the war. Can you tell us more about this time? I know.
Well, I could go over. I could tell a lot during that particular, I don't know what I could tell. Yes, I was there during the war. I had been there X numbers of times, but I actually flew there when war started. I flew there immediately and to see what one could do and try to help to stabilize the situation. I think that succeeded to some extent. I wouldn't necessarily say it was because of my efforts. Others were involved as well. But it was difficult, and I think what we did subsequently was very important in terms of stabilizing Georgia. Because if you look at Georgia up until then, Rose Revolution, economic reforms had been very successful, in my opinion. It was very much dependent upon sort of inflow of investments and capital and financial stability. And what happened with the war, of course, and with the prospect or the danger, which was widely discussed at the time, of the Russian army is not stopping where they stop, but marching into Tbilisi. I think the most difficult issue that we faced was the possibility of financial and political collapse of Georgia as an effect of the war. There, the international community, primarily the European Union and to some extent the US, stepped in. And we stepped in within a month or two with substantial infusions of capital into the Georgian system. That stabilized the Georgian economy, which stabilized the political system of Georgia and prevented the collapse that might well have been there in the calculation of some on the other side of the Caucasus. So that also underlines what I've said. You have a military dimension, you have a political dimension of any conflict, but you also have the financial and the stability. Then we were trying to set up, that was the effort negotiated by President Sarkozy of France, that was the, they had the EU presidency at the time with President Putin in Moscow, some sort of peacemaking or structures. The kindest things that can be said about those is that they haven't worked and that we now have a very frozen conflict, but which has a rather tragic effect. Georgia has been doing, there are some problems in Georgia, but not related to this. South Ossetia, which is a very small place, has been, I wouldn't say depopulated, but the population there is probably half of what it was. So we are down to probably 20, 25,000 people, we don't really know. No functioning economy. I mean, it depended upon subsidies from Moscow, all of it, all depending on supplies through one tunnel through the Caucasus. It's not viable. It's not viable. Abkhazia, which used to be one of the jewels of the Soviet Union in terms of climate and tourist potential and whatever, everyone, Stalin and Beria, whatever, had their villas there, enjoyed it, Soviet leadership, Sochi is a shadow, is now a fairly desperate place. I mean, in economic decay and in political isolation. While Georgia survived the conflicts, South Ossetia and Abkhazia are not doing very well. And of course, Russia did immediately. They said, we recognize these as independent states. And no one, well, not quite true. I think Nicaragua has recognized them, and Venezuela. And there could be some island somewhere. But they didn't even manage to get Belarus. Not to speak about all of the other countries, Kazakhstan, not even the closest friends of Russia recognize that independence.
Okay, if my intro, we have four more question requests and don't have much time, so let us ask those four questions in a row, okay. And then we'll have one longer answer.
Mr. Prime Minister, I'm the ambassador of Switzerland, and you as a former foreign minister, you know, a diplomat has to watch his language. Because with a stroke of a pen of a foreign minister, you can be sent to Ouagadougou, but I take a risk now. In your descriptions, you mentioned, you hinted to the phenomenon that we have a Security Council, UN Security Council, that can, you know, that can determine if we can act as the international community or if we are completely paralyzed. And we are seeing it constantly. And, you know, out of the five members of the Security Councils, they are, if, you know, if I stretch the word democracy, we have three democracies and then three other systems. Two other systems. Now, how do you go on and make state building when you have two systems who are not supporting, promoting democracy? And I'm saying it now referring to a posting I had before last. My last posting was Hanoi, and before I was 4 years in Sudan. 4 years to the day until they separated. So 4 years preparing the separation because we knew they would separate. And I've seen countries, members of the Security Council, sabotaging our work constantly. Weapons were going into Darfur, weapons were flowing while we are bringing, you know, everybody who wanted, we were bringing our best. We were bringing the central bankers to teach the Southerners how to build their new republic, we were all working our butts off, and the sabotaging of some powers was spectacular, and we have a tragedy in Southern Sudan. We have not spoken even about it. So you are now a free man, Mr. Prime Minister. You have no masters except maybe, as you know, Bob Dylan taught us, God. So could you maybe scream out there that we have some deficiencies in our architecture? Thank you very much.
Marcin Korolec, former environment and climate minister, and I can testify our bilateral relation in the environment is excellent. I work closely with Lena Ek and Asa Romsson, your colleague in the government. My question is about Europe. I like very much the title of your speech, From Crisis to Stability. And exactly it is a sense of my question, because we are facing number of crises, Brexit, Greek crisis, refugee crisis, to name a few. So what about Europe in 10 years? Shall we have 30 members or 31 members with Switzerland, Ukraine and Turkey in, or shall we have 25 members without UK, without Poland, and without, I don't know, maybe Denmark? So how you judge Europe in 5 or 10 years from now? And what could be an idea uniting us in the future? Thank you very much.
Thank you for this opportunity. Mohammed Abdul Karim, Embassy of the State of Qatar. Having in mind your Excellency, the title, you have mentioned the comeback of the geopolitics. And do you think that the balance of the power and geopolitics is one of the solutions that for the future world? And also having in mind Europe, the foreign policy of Europe, and that we realize that something which we call a renationalization of the foreign policy of Europe. So is it also a solution for getting out of the crisis? Thank you.
And one more.
Andriy Deshyter, Ambassador of Ukraine. I'm very glad to see you call here in Warsaw. And using this opportunity, would like to thank you for your strong support of Ukraine during the Russian invasion and for your support of Ukraine-EU perspective and EU press. But coming back to the title of your lecture about stability, which is not over, it's not yet in Eastern Ukraine, what do you think? If it's enough that the diplomatic talks, negotiations are enough, or other means should be deployed to reach this stability?
That was it. No problem, no problem, easy. Start with the Security Council, yes. There are three democracies, not quite democracies, to put it very mildly. Sometimes it works anyhow. I mean, go back 20 years in time to the Bosnia peace operation. As a matter of fact, could be said today, believe it or not, but we worked very constructively with Russia during that particular period. I've had two periods when I worked extremely constructively with Russian diplomats. First was when we had, go back even further a couple of years, when we had the reestablishment of the independence of the three Baltic states. And that was, of course, from the Russian point of view, somewhat sensitive, because they had not been sort of Soviet satellites like Poland. They had been part of the Soviet Union itself. So that reestablishment was a complicated procedure, and there were, of course, very substantial and, has to be said, strategically for Russia important facilities in the Baltic states. And we had to manage the process of the withdrawal and replacement of those particular things. We did that very constructively together with Moscow. The same applies in the latter stages of the Bosnian operation or the Bosnia war. and the Bosnia peace operation. Mr. Andrei Kosirev was foreign minister of Russia at the time, and he was one of my best and most knowledgeable interlocutors and supporters in that particular effort. So there have been times that have been different. Then politics have gone off, of course, in somewhat different directions, to put it somewhat mildly. I didn't mention South Sudan. When I was jotting down my remarks, I questioned whether I would bring up South Sudan or Yemen to take another of the examples, but it would have been too much. I think South Sudan, historians will have to go over that one. Yes, they were heading for some sort of separation. That was obvious for some time. But there was enormous naivety concerning the possibility of setting up a functioning state in South Sudan. And some of the powers, notably one, was the incarnation of that naivety, I would have to say, and didn't prepare it enough. And some others might have been sort of for short-term interest undermining it. But I think what we learn from an example like that is have to undermine it at some point in time. It's going to come back and haunt you. South Sudan is now, it is a fail, well, it's hardly even a failed state, because it's hardly even a state with enormous humanitarian challenges. Yemen, same, 26 million people. 20 or 30,000 of those have already come across the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb to go to Djibouti in order to flee the country. And here I think it's imperative for the members of the Security Council to understand it's only by acting together that there's any chance of success. If they undermine each other, they will all fail the one way or the other. Where will then Europe be in 10 years' time? Well, easy question, in the sense that I don't know. That's the answer to that question. But I think what happens these years will be very important. And the most important issue is the British issue. We've gone from, Sweden wasn't part of it, from 6 to 28 members. Has that been good or bad? Of course it has been good, because it has given a period of peace and prosperity to Europe that is unthinkable. The development of Poland would not have been possible without it. The development of Sweden would have been possible, but not as good without it. So no question that this has been good. If this is reversed by one major country going out, that will, first, it's got to be very complicated to handle for a couple of years. Then it might inspire others to do the same. And then we'll see a fracturing of Europe with rather devastating consequences also for our possibility to handle both the security challenges that we face in the East and the rather diverse also security challenges that we face in the South. Do I think this will happen? I don't know, but I think that what will happen is that in a crisis situation as we're having, that could be, it was a euro, migration, Russia, or whatever, I think there's a recognition by every head of state and government in Europe that they can't handle it alone. It's only by acting together that there's any chance of achieving anything. There's no guarantee of success. We might fail anyhow. But if we go off in different direction, we can be dead certain that we're going to fail. And if you sit in the position of a prime minister or president or whatever, you see these realities fairly clearly. You think that prime ministers and presidents are powerful, yes. But if you sit in the position of a prime minister and president, I can assure you from my personal experience and from those I know, you don't feel the power, you feel that you're powerless in a situation like this. And it's only by merging your efforts with other countries that you can do anything. So in spite of all of these challenges, I do think that Europe will be driven together by the recognition of the fact that in this world, we are only 7% of the world, that is coming together and where far away issues impact upon us. It's only by acting together that we can have any chance of success. The question about balance of power and such things. I mean, what we've been trying to do in Europe is, of course, to, somewhat naively you might say, go away from the balance of power and build security on integration rather than I mean, we go back to the Cold War, we were building security on military deterrence. Now we are trying to build security on political and economic integration. To go away from the balance of power concept. And I think if Europe were to slide back into balance of power context, and Europe is a complex place, it will destabilize Europe quite substantially. I don't say by that the balance of power politics is unnecessary. You need to balance some powers that are clearly outside of the system. And if you go to the situations in East Asia with the rise of China and all of that, clearly we are more in what Henry Kissinger and others would call a Westphalian world, while we in Europe are still struggling to get away from that particular Westphalian word. Ukraine and the East and where we are. I think it's important to recognize that if we go back somewhat more than a year in time to the April and May of last year, President Putin was absolutely convinced that he was going to create what he called a Nova Russia, and he was going to do that within 2 or 3 months. He was absolutely convinced it was going to happen because he thought that Ukraine was going to unravel and he could use some military sources and propaganda and political operations of some sort, and it would go as easily as he thought that Crimea went. That did not happen. That did not happen. He failed. And he's now stuck with parts of Luhansk and Donetsk, 2 million people, 3 million people, or whatever. And you can argue substantial economic resources, but of decaying importance, I would argue. And what will he do with this? His long-term objective is clearly still there, in order to destabilize Ukraine and prevent it from being too integrated with the European Union. But what does he need to do with this particular part of it? The people that are there, I mean, the leaders that he inserted there, some of them are from there, some of them are not from there. He have exchanged some of them. They have also taken away some of them that they didn't particularly like, that were unruly. Some of them have been shot de facto. They can be fairly effective and brutal when they do things. But a lot of them now feel betrayed by Moscow, because Moscow promised them a glorious future in a Nova Russia and a big state. And suddenly President Putin delivers a lengthy lecture in the Kremlin yesterday where Ukraine is not even mentioned. They feel betrayed. And I think this will be a problem for Russia. I'm not saying it's not a problem for Ukraine. It is a problem for Ukraine. We know that. But I think it's going to be increasingly a problem for Russia. And at some point in time, I would argue that the best would be to do what we did in another aspect, another part of the Balkans. We had a peacekeeping operation in a place called Eastern Slavonia of Croatia. That was a portion of Croatia which had been taken over by the Serbs. It had a mixed population, but it had taken over by sort of Serb armies. They had set up an independent republic, by the way. And then there was an agreement that sort of the borders should be reestablished and all of those things that we are now talking about in the Minsk Agreement. But this could not be done without a UN peacekeeping operation. And that was sent in there, UNTAIS. It worked for 2 years. And I wouldn't say that everything was a smashing success, but 80% worked. And none of you here today has heard of the Eastern Slavonia problem for the past 15 years, I would venture to say. And that means that you can do these things, and I think it would be at some point in time in the interest, needless to say, of Ukraine, but also in the interest of Russia, and certainly in the interest of European security, if this were to happen. I am saying this with the reservation that so far our efforts to try to get resolution to a frozen conflict like Transnistria, which should not be too difficult to resolve, as a matter of fact, has not been particularly successful, because the willingness haven't been there. But if the will is there, it's doable.
Thank you very much. I wish we had more time, but unfortunately we need to finish at this point. So thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your attention. And
And final announcements. We have prepared a small reception for all of you. It takes place at the minus one level, which is two floors below us. Take the stairs next to the main door to the building. Be our guests.